just got an email from him last week where he wanted to meet up and show me what he's doing at his new job. And so what he, it's a great idea. So he's an engineer for a company that's trying to make an automated cafe. So the idea is they buy off-the-shelf juice machines, there's regular coffee makers, they got an espresso machine. And what they did is they set up a bunch of robots, and you type in, you say, hey, I'm gonna be there in 5 minutes and I want an espresso. And the robot comes over here, grabs a cup, goes over to the espresso machine, pushes the right buttons, and then takes it and sets it on a conveyor belt, and the conveyor belt robot takes it off the conveyor belt and puts it in a cup. And one of the first things, so he showed me how it worked, one of the first things he said is, you can see all the linear algebra we're using here. And the one he pointed out was, you've got the robot's coordinate system, and you've got the coordinate system of the real world space, then you have to do a mapping between those two coordinate systems, which is exactly what we've been lecturing on here. So kind of the way I want you to think about this class is, of course, you're never really going to solve a problem where you've got horses and humans and you make the hypercentaurs and the anticentaurs. What you are getting out of this class are a bunch of mathematical tools that we believe, at least, are going to be useful for solving the problems you're going to run into whatever career you have. And then, he was showing me the different operations, and then the CTO, the Chief Technology Officer, came in. I was introduced as Ori's math teacher. And the first thing he said to me was, wow, I wish I knew more linear algebra. And they both agreed that in the robotics stuff, it's all linear algebra. And they essentially have to go back and teach themselves or learn the parts of linear algebra they wish they had in their classes. I've complained about this before. You guys get 18 units of calculus and 3 units of linear algebra. I'll bet if you go back in your career, these 3 units of linear algebra will be more useful than the 18 units of calculus. So, in 3.4, this is my yay linear algebra speech. So in 3.4, the idea is you've got a certain problem to solve. And instead of working with the coordinates that are given to us directly, we're going to make our own coordinate system and then solve the problem in that coordinate system. And this coordinate system will be a lot easier. This will be a lot easier to solve the problem looked at from this perspective. And then at the end, if we need to, we can go back to the original. So remember, the original problem is we had a bunch of horses and a bunch of humans, and we saw 100 heads. So some combination of horses and humans. But by making hypercentaurs and anticentaurs, is the anticentaurs didn't have any heads. So if we knew we had 100 heads, the only way that could come from was how many hypercentaurs we had. So that was an easier problem. I've got hypercentaurs with 2 heads each, anti-centaurs with 0 heads. I've got 100 heads total. How many hypercentaurs did I need? That's an easier question. And then I went to a second version of this. And we were talking about a problem we did earlier, projecting a vector onto a given line. And the two things I know is I know how to project a vector onto the x-axis. And what we just talked about is I can make my own custom x-axis if I want to. So, a couple things. I want to project onto the x-axis. I guess this is a picture. X1 turns into x0. And there's a matrix that does that for us. 1000. did this in chapter two. We're revisiting this problem with the tool of making your own coordinate system. So to find the matrix that projects onto the line y equals 3x. The intuition. Take this. So it's in linear algebra, the way we describe a coordinate system is with vectors. The direction of the vector tells us the direction of the axis, and the length of the vector is what represents one particular mark. So this, let's go this way, there's x, there's y. If I extend this out, make those my tick marks, and extend this up, make those my tick marks. This is our linear algebra way of describing the regular xy coordinate system that you learned back in elementary school. But my system is I want y equals 3x be my new x-axis. And in linear algebra, the way I describe a coordinate system, this is going to be my x-hat, is I need a vector on that line. So give me any vector you want. That's what we're going to represent as a length 1. And this is the formula for making the vector. So pick anything you want for x. The y-coordinate has to be 1, 3 is one of many possible choices. So my new coordinate system is my x hat is going to be 1, 3. And then we'll talk later about non-perpendicular coordinate systems. Coordinate systems are easier to work with. So I want to come up with a vector that goes up like this. It's perpendicular to the first one. How do I check to see if two vectors are perpendicular? Dot product is 0. But so the dot product is, for now, you'll do a lot of things for us, but for now, it's a perpendicular checker.
Yeah, minus 3, 1.
Good. So if I make minus 3, 1, if I just switch those, and because I wanted my y hat up here, I'll make the first one negative. You see, when I do the dot product, I get 0. Just some names. We use script S to stand for the standard basis. That's the basis for the coordinate system for R2 that you've been doing almost your whole life. And then for this problem, I'll make my new coordinate system, which is described by this basis. Essentially, what I'm trying to do trying to find the matrix that projects the arbitrary vector xy onto the line y equals 3x. And when we write the vector this way, like when I write that 1, 3, what that really means is 1 in the x direction, 3 in the y direction, is that's really using the standard coordinate system that you've always been using. So I've got a three-step process here. So convert x, y to x hat, y hat coordinates. Project onto the x hat axis. Convert this projection that we calculated in step two back to xy coordinates. Maybe I should erase over there. Writing lots of stuff down. E to U. I give a name to this, as I described, converting from standard coordinates to, for converting from the standard basis, my new basis is S to B, and then converting B coordinates back to S coordinates, I write this way. Okay, so one of those two conversions, I can take this basis and turn it into a matrix. Is this B to S or is this S to B?
Yeah.
Which one?
Anyway.
B to S.
B to S.
That is B to S.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Did you change the B from the first one?
Oh, whoops.
It was, yeah.
Good point. Thanks for noticing that. Unintentionally. So that's B to S. So is that step one, step two, or step three?
Correct.
So step three is going to be 1, 3, -3, 1. Step two, well, we talked about how to project onto an x-axis. That's 1, 0, 0, 1. This one's B to S. How do I go the other way? What matrix is going to do S to B? Good. Yeah, S to B is just the inverse of this matrix. I'm not going to bother with the calculations. Together. So I'm going to take the xy, and when I do step one, I want to hit it with this matrix first. So that means I'm going to hit it with the 1, 3, -3, 1 inverse. This projection 1, 0, 0, 0, So the matrix that does the projection for us is the matrix we get by computing this and then doing those matrix multiplications that we did earlier. So convert this, this matrix will convert x, y into my new coordinate system, project it onto the new x-axis, and then convert that answer back to the standard coordinate system. And there's one more thing I want to show you. And this will be a good preview for chapter 7. We're going to be doing more interesting. We're going to be talking about how to design our coordinate system. Still in 3.4. So for some reason, I'm looking at a transformation that takes an input vector here, and the new x coordinate is obtained by doing this, and the new y coordinate is that. The nice thing in linear algebra is we can write all of our functions as matrix times a vector. All the calculations here, as we've done before, are being done in the standard basis. What I want to do is do the same transformation. This is my favorite basis, my second favorite basis anyway. So I'm going to do exactly that transformation, except this time we're going to do it with respect to this basis. So in other words, what I want is a matrix that when you give me a vector in the x hat, y hat system, I apply the matrix to get this, the output, which will be the same vectors I would have gotten here, except the coordinates of that output will be with respect to this new basis. And if I draw a picture, it's going to be easier to describe than doing that with words. This picture means is I'm working relative to the standard basis, and I have a transformation that takes two-dimensional vectors as inputs, takes this matrix times the input to produce an output. Same transformation, but I describe the inputs and outputs relative to this B basis. What's the matrix that I get here? about, I've got a vector that represents some input. That vector is just an arrow on the right, on the whiteboard. I can write it in terms of the B basis, or I can write it in terms of the S basis. So what I want to do is I want to get from here to here. Yes.
So, but when you have to convert your the matrix that you currently have to the...
That's actually what we're doing. So we're trying to figure out what, so this is the matrix that corresponds to doing it if I go across up here, is what's the matrix that's going to represent doing it down here. So when I think about this is I'm trying to get from here to here. One thing I can do is go up here, go across this way, and then go back down. So from here to here, is I can do that as a three-step process. So for step one, am I converting B coordinates to S coordinates or S coordinates to B coordinates?
B to S.
B to S. And then step two, well, that's what we were given. That's the matrix that does this for us. And then what's step three? What's the conversion?
That's the B.
So applying this matrix, the one I'm trying to find, is going to be the same thing as applying the B to S matrix, then applying the given matrix, and then applying the S to B. So in other words, this is exactly what matrix multiplication is built for. In order to get that mystery matrix I'm looking for, multiply the three matrices here. And remember, the order we have to do it in, it goes right to left. So first, second, third. So step one is B to S. Step two is this guy. And then step three is S to B. And now I keep losing these. So my B matrix is 1, 1, negative 1, 1. And I can think about this as coming from the column space of that matrix. This is a conversion matrix. Is this B to S or S to B? That's B to S. And the B to S goes right here. Step two, so I've got this one. And then step three, if this is my B to S matrix, how do I get my S to B matrix?
Inverse.
Inverse. So if I do the matrix multiplication and put all those together, remember, the reason we like the hypercentaur, anticentaur coordinate system is the anticentaurs didn't have any heads. And what that meant in terms of the matrix is that we had a zero in this slot. So what you're gonna find. Is that all this multiplies nicely together to make a bunch of zeros. So we'll talk about that in a minute. And we'll talk about why we like that. While you're marveling at how simple that matrix is, what we're going to be doing in chapter 7 is you're going to start with this matrix, and then you're going to come up with this coordinate system to make the matrix in that new coordinate system as simple as possible. So now, I'm giving you this basis, and you're working it out, you make this. In chapter 7, I'm going to show you the secret on how to pick this basis for that matrix. So far, so good? No? Let's look at the picture again.
That matrix on the right is the resultant matrix of that whole multiplication?
Can I multiply this whole thing?
Okay. Yes.
Watch how nice this is. So imagine that I'm over here in this output space, and in the B coordinate system, I want the output to be 28, negative 11. So in other words, I want to solve this equation. And this is going to be much easier to solve than something if I told you the output I wanted here. So on the left side, this says 4x's plus 0y's. So 4x's plus 0y's is 28. So how many x's do I need?
7.
And the bottom line tells me 0 x's minus a y gives me negative 11. So what was the y originally? I want this output 21, negative 11. And given that this is the matrix that does the transformation, I can easily see that the input must be 7, 11. So problem, if I ask for the corresponding problem here, is if I said there was an output I want you to get, you would have had to solve a whole system of equations. But because this matrix had these zeros here, it was very easy to solve this system. Okay, so that's going to be, we'll talk more about that. It took me a while. I eventually got this class to be a prerequisite for Math 3F for differential equations. It's in differential equations, you're going to have a big complicated system of equations to solve. What you're going to do is introduce a new coordinate system. So instead, it just turns into a bunch of equations that are what we call decoupled from each other. So they're isolated from each other. So just like you can find the x coordinate just based on this and the y coordinate based on that, you'll solve that decoupled system and then convert it back. I think that's all I need to tell you about chapter 3. So in a perfect world, you can just look at this and ignore it. And do all the homework problems. Realistically, they're very easy, but it's not clear that they are that easy. I'm going to skip the fundamental theorem of linear algebra lecture right now. If we have time, we'll do it later. Okay.
by 11.
I was given. So this is the problem I want to solve. So it's like working in this coordinate system. I give you this output. That's the output I want. I'm going to ask you for the input to produce it. Essentially, I'm going to give you some hints for the homework for chapter 3 here. So, what we talked about. I would give you a space. Some subspace, and then the best way to describe that subspace is the span of some list of vectors. We want to find a basis for the subspace of all vectors perpendicular to both of these. So we're in some four-dimensional space. And then I'm going to pick two of those vectors, allow it to make a two-dimensional subspace. And then I want to look at everything that's perpendicular to those two. So you'll be doing this on every exam. I want you to find some mathematical description of all things that have a certain property. Remember the steps? Make a generic object. So what does a generic object that I'm looking for look like?
X1, X2, X3, X4,
good. And I've got enough variables on the left, yes. I agree. Okay, then write the conditions down.
Got it.
So I got this. 1, 2, 3, 4, what do I get?
Zero.
And my generic object that I'm trying to get.
Two dorms.
If I got it to this, I get 0. So then, convert your conditions into a system of equations. If you solve this system of equations, you'll have the answer to what we're looking for. So that could have been a chapter 2 question. Is I'm going to change this slightly. Version of that system of equations says to solve this. And then this should remind you of another word that we had in this class, is I've got a matrix, and then I find a vector that a matrix times that vector is 0. What do we call that?
Null space.
Null space. Thank you. another way to write this problem is you're finding the null space of that matrix. What I found is there's some homework problems. Actually, no, let's go back. So there's a bunch of homework problems where we'll have some subspace in mind and we'll ask for a description of it. And the standard way of getting the description is by making it a basis or something. But another way to describe this subspace is to say it is the null space of some matrix. So another way to describe the subspace is to say it's the null space of some matrix. And a third way to describe a subspace is to say it's the column space of some matrix. So we're kind of turning this around. Is the problem I gave you before was, here's a matrix, find a basis for the null space. Here's a matrix, find a basis for the column space. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, here's the subspace. This, find a matrix, so it's the null space of your matrix. Or find a matrix, so it's the column space of your matrix. Right, so I'll describe a space, and you're going to come up with these representations. Start off easy. Is remember the column space of a matrix is all the vectors we can get by making all linear combinations of columns. Matrix has columns 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, then the column space of A is just the span of this list. And then what about that list that makes it a basis?
It's linearly independent.
Yeah, they're linearly independent. There's no redundant vectors. So if I go the other way, I give you the basis for the space and want you to find a matrix so that my space is, my subspace is the column space of that matrix. Yeah, the problem I find is students just make this problem a lot harder than they need to. So what's a matrix where this is the column space?
That.
And be careful, there's a difference between these two. This is a list of vectors, this is a matrix. So those parentheses now. There's a bunch of homework problems. I'm going to give you a basis. I'm going to describe a space by giving you its basis. I'm going to ask you to find a matrix so the subspace is the column space of that matrix. space version is a bit harder. So in calc 3, and it's, you'll learn that this equation describes a plane. And any plane through the origin is a subspace. You to do here is to find a matrix A, so that plane is the column space of A, and I want you to find a matrix B, such that plane is the null space of B. Previously did a problem like this. Here's a subspace. Find a matrix so that subspace is the column space of the matrix. What's the easy way to do it? Is if we had a basis for A, then we could use those basis elements to build a matrix. So, easy way to do problems like this. Is to find a basis for W. So this is a system of equations. And we've done this part before. We parameterize the infinitely many solutions. So Z is a free choice. Y is a free choice. And then X is this. Break it up. Go ahead and get caught up, or if you're caught up already, use this basis that I found here to answer part A. You guys ready? So, if I have the description of A in the Baker, the description of W in the basis form, and I want to write it in the column space form, it's I just end up taking so far, so good. So again, that's once you have that basis, it's easy to make a matrix whose column space is the domain. So either I give you the basis directly, or it's a problem you've done already, where I describe what I want, you come up with the basis, and once you have the basis, you make it. I'm gonna show you a couple of things. I don't know if I showed you this, but I should. You see that I can think of this top part as being a dot product. It's the vector 1, 2, 3 dotted with the vector x, y, z. Remember how dot what products work? It's cross. So looked at through the lens of linear algebra, what does this say about the vector x, y, z?
Perpendicular.
It's perpendicular to 1, 2, 3. So in Calc 3, you're going to learn that this is called the normal vector. My description of the plane is I give you something that's perpendicular to everything in that plane. If you have that vector, and you can make the plane like this, here's everything perpendicular to it. So another description of a plane is to give you a normal vector. Okay, then, it's remember how dot products work, 1 times x, 2 times y, 3 times z. Is if I write this vector sideways, is doing the finger trick. Do you see that this is another way to write the dot product of those two vectors? You see that? Okay, so I did 1 times x plus 2 times y plus 3 times z. But looked at another way, is think about this vector as a matrix now. That matrix times x, y, z is in zero. Zero. What's in it, what word or what concept does that remind you of?
Null space.
Null space, exactly. So another way to say this is that x, y, z is in the null space of 1, 2, 3. Got all that? So again, this is the equation that describes the plane, which is always a good way to describe things. It's another equation. All the x, y, and z that outbreak can satisfy that. Using some concepts from this class, we can rewrite this as a dot product. This just says the dot product is zero. And then, is we can write dot products as a matrix multiplication. It says when I do this fixed matrix times my generic x, y, z, I get zero. Another way to say that, matrix times vector is zero, is to say that the vector is in the null space of that matrix. So what I was trying to do over here was to find a matrix B such that W is equal to the null space of this matrix. What's my matrix B? 1, 2, 3. Again, I know that when this shows up on the homework, well, actually, everything I said there goes back to concepts we already talked about in the class. So there's no new concepts there. It's just homework is your chance to put everything together. I'm trying to give you some tools to do that. Instead of describing W as an equation, I'm going to describe W with a basis. And then I want you to find a matrix. So the two matrices. I want W to be the column space of that matrix, and I want W to be the null space of that matrix. Let's go column space first. That you can do in your head. What's A?
3, 2, 1.
And so I want to focus on this. So to say that this is a basis for W means that everything in W can be written as a linear combination of these points. And we just have one here. So to say that x, y, z is a W means that x, y, z is some multiple of 3, 2, 1. In other words, x, y, z is 3t, 2t. Going back to the equation form, we must have x equal to 3t, y equal to 2t, and z equal to t. And this reminds me of making z a completely free choice, and then y is based on that, and x is based on that. So if z is t, that's just the free choice. And the equation before that should have been y minus 2z is 0. And what was the equation to get the x? X minus 3z plus 0. So then that means that in matrix, so we go from basis to all the possible solutions to a parameterized solution to the infinitely many equations to what those equations must have been to start out with. And then this can get translated into that. And then you can say this in using the words null space. What's the sentence?
XYZ
is in the null space. Good. So for XYZ to be in W, that means that XYZ has to be in the null space of this matrix. basis for W, I want you to find a matrix such that W is the null space of that matrix. How do you guys feel if I erase right here? Say that this is a basis for W. It says that any vector in W can be written as a linear combination of these basis elements. Change this problem slightly. How was it?
Yeah, I think it should be -3, 0, or -3, 1, 0. Okay, but then the other one would have to be different.
Okay. Let's just go ahead and do the homework problem.
The original, the first one was -2, 1, 0.
Okay. And then the other one would have to be -3, 0, 1.
Yeah, -3, 0, 1.
Okay. There we go. So based on this, what's x?
-2 plus -2.
What's y?
S.
What's z?
T.
Good. So we're essentially rowing backwards from a system of equations with infinitely many solutions. Z was a free choice. Y was a free choice. X was forced. Write it this way. So substituting back in, we get that X is -2y - 3z. Or in other words, we were starting with this equation, x + 2y + 3z = 0. We can break this down as a matrix times x, y, z. What's the matrix?
1, 2, 3, 4.
Stuff in the middle. But I said in order for x, y, z to be a W, is x, y, z needs to be in the null space of this matrix. So the answer to my question, the matrix B is row 1, 2, 3. Two more problems I want to into this. Use these words. So find a non-trivial relation on this set of vectors. So I'm trying to put these three vectors together to get zero. You wish you had an easy way to do it? If I take zero of each of those, I'm going to get that. Too easy, right?
Yeah.
So when we say non-trivial, it means we're not allowed to do the 0, 0, 0 solution. I don't want to make it too easy. So let's call these X, Y, and Z. I'm going to use a language that we've been developing in this chapter. Another way to look at this problem is find a non-trivial X, Y, Z, or non-trivial vector X, Y, Z that satisfies this equation. In other words, we want to find a non-trivial X, Y, Z that's in the null space of this matrix A. And do you know how to find a basis for the null space of a matrix? Essentially, you do. And so it's all related. So finding the non-trivial relation is just finding something interesting in those space. Finally, coordinate system make our own coordinate system. Okay, so first of all, diagonal matrix means every entry off the main diagonal is zero. If I reflect the vector x, y about the x-axis, where does it end up? If I had to do that with a matrix, what would it be?
1, 0, 0, negative 1.
So that is a diagonal matrix. So if I made a coordinate system where this was my new x-axis, then reflecting about that x-axis would be this matrix. You know how to do that? I'm going to make an x-hat, y-hat system. X-hat is going to be a vector on here. We did this before. 1, 3, -3. So in the right coordinate system, you can make a reflecting matrix, and you can make a projection matrix into diagonal matrices. It's almost over, isn't it? This goes fast. Okay. I am going to call us done with chapter 3. Lecture notes for chapter 3. Done. And on Monday, we'll start chapter 4.